All right, welcome everybody. Sup up with my trade talks and my midweek review. Let me know if you have any questions in the room. Just drop them into the chat. Anything you want me to go over, any chart requests. Basically, my time is your time, so you let me know what you want to do. So before we get into it, just a quick disclaimer. Obviously, this information I'm presenting is for educational purposes only, not intended to be any specific trading advice. Past performance is no guarantee of future performance. Investment in trading carries significant risk, loss. You should consult your financial professional before investing or trading. Now that we got that out of the way, let's just to have a quick chat about today. So obviously, the likes of Moderna, Pfizer, and other vaccine stocks were on the move. Stay at home plays, Peloton, Zoom had some nice movements as well. And as you can see on my watch list, Meli, Restoration Hardware, Facebook, Zscaler, Micron, Decent Days, Airbnb, not bad as well. I didn't have Snap in here because I wasn't really watching Snap, but let's throw Snap in there. Snap had a pretty good day, up almost 5%. So, you know, we can go through some of those charts. First, let's kind of go back. Let's just take a quick look. So today's Wednesday. Let's just go through some weekly charts. Let's just zoom through them, so to speak. So here's Moderna, looking pretty good on the weekly. Zoom, nice weekly breakout so far. And of course, we want to wait till the end of the week to see where we land. But you could see from this previous swing high at around 600, we had a rejection here that drew our line. We had a false breakout last week. And then we had a swing low anchored VWAP tap on both weeks. And now we're thrusting through the high over the channel. So other thing to note, RSI came back down to 50 and bounced. And we do have a weekly squeeze that started to set up a month ago. And now that squeeze is starting to fire off. So Zoom looking pretty good going into the end of the week. Let's take a quick look at Snapchat. Again, pretty good week. We had some bullish hidden divergence back here where you have RSI making a lower high and price making a higher high. And so you had Snap come up to its weekly wedge, break out, nice throwback retest right here, 2 weeks in a row, popped right off on earnings. And now we've had two inside weeks so far. So what I like about this setup is we're starting to get a bit of a hammer forming here in this second inside week. As I pointed out, we did have a squeeze setting up back here. We're three dots into a weekly squeeze. The earnings week kicked off and fired off our squeeze. Now the next 2 weeks we've been consolidating. So one thing I'm looking at here, so price is making a higher high. RSI is making a lower high. That, of course, can resolve itself if we get a breakout this week or next. So let's just keep an eye on Snap. It's looking pretty good. I think we may get a test of all-time highs right here at around 79.18. But if we do see that breakout, you know, I do think this divergence will, this bearish divergence will resolve. Let's take a quick look at Meli. Let's see, Mercado Libre. Don't have this charted on the weekly, but we can just draw out our lines real quick. So obviously we have a breakout. We also have another weekly squeeze setting up. So let's drop that in there. Haven't looked at this on the weekly, I'm assuming. So it's looking pretty good. We had an RSI breakout back here on the weekly, right? Broke 50 as well, back tested 50, continuing higher. So Mercado Libre looking pretty good. I won't chart this out too in depth, but if we just take a look at a Fib retracement, you can see we're struggling at the 50% retracement here. So what I would say is above the 50%, 1634, we get a weekly close over that, you can expect price to come up to that 618 for a test at 1722. Next up is Restoration Hardware. This has become one of my favorite types of setups. It's called an inside-outside key reversal. And basically the setup is you have one candle. So it could be weekly, it could be daily, it could be really any time frame. I like these on the weeklies and the dailies because they play out really nicely. But so basically you have your initial candle, then you have an inside week, and then you have an outside week. So right now we are showing an outside week on Restoration Hardware. However, it is a spinning top. And in order for this to really play out, we would need Restoration Hardware to close over 682 by the end of this week. If we close over 682, then I think we have a really good opportunity to test the highs at 700 and then possibly up to 720. If we close below 663, then this could be a play to the downside. So the one thing I'll say is, you know, we're forming what looks to be a bull pennant. So again, we just need to wait for this week to play out. Of course, we can play this intra week. We also do have a TTM squeeze setting up on the weekly here. So let's see how this plays out, but Restoration Hardware looking pretty good for a continuation. Facebook, not really much dark cover cloud weekly candle here, which usually signifies a change in direction, change in trend. That's certainly what we're seeing so far this week. Although, again, the week is still young, but look at the squeeze momentum turning down. So, you know, just be careful on Facebook into the end of the week. Next up is Zscaler. Zscaler looks really good. It's coming into my target zone off of this swing high, swing low. RSI breakout, no squeezes to note. But looking pretty good to test 250 this week, possibly upwards of 260. Next up is Micron. Been watching this one. So we pulled right into our 382 from this swing low to this swing high. So when you have a nice strong trend and it's more of a vertical type of trend, what I like to look for is kind of a slow, choppy grind into that 382. Exactly what we got right here. And although we did deviate from it here, you know, these levels, we also have to treat them more as zones versus perfect numbers. Sometimes they hit perfectly, sometimes they don't. In this case, they didn't, but you could see we had almost a bullish reversal candle here. Then you had a hammer, and now we've got a continuation candle. So if we draw out our RSI, we haven't quite broken RSI yet, although RSI did break 50, which I like. So if you take the more short-term RSI, we did break that today. So it's looking pretty good for a continuation. We did break and hold 81, which was my trigger entry today, and we closed at 82. We did hit a high of 83.20. So looking pretty good on MU, Micron. Airbnb, possible double bottom here, double bottom reversal on the weekly. So you have one bottom here, you have a second bottom here, beautiful bounce. But really for me to get excited about Airbnb, I wanna see this over 154, like 154, 155. You could see these two wicks on the weekly came right up to it and stopped. We had our third fake out. You know, that's generally a signal when you get a fake out breakout and a close under, you usually get a reversal. We got that two candle reversal here. Now you have your third candle and you're getting another reversal off of the previous low. So it could play out very much like just a choppy zone where we're just chopping, you know, in this level. So we'll just have to wait and see how this plays out in the coming weeks. But if we do get a close over 154.90 on the weekly for Airbnb, then I would be bullish that we could possibly come up to maybe this 173 level and see where we're going from there. Chipotle, CMG, burritos are strong with this one. So you could see we did break these recent highs 2-3 weeks ago. Continuation. So nice high and tight flag. If we went down to a lower time frame, you know, it'd be a little more evident, but it's looking pretty good for continuation. think over 1900, you can see maybe a 20 to 30 point pop once we get a daily close over it, but looking pretty good on CMG. We talked about Airbnb. PDD, not looking too great. Most China stocks aren't. Fiverr, we had the breakout. The retest failed. We're testing the swing high anchored VWAP here. Very important that Fiverr closes over 228 this week. We have a failed RSI breakout, but the squeeze is setting up. So if we see a close back over this downtrend line, that could be a signal to go long on Fiverr with a stop under just about 224. So that's what I'd be looking for on Fiverr. Tesla is setting up as well. It is breaking its wedge here. You know, 2-week candle break on the wedge. We have an inverted hammer forming. We also have a weekly squeeze setting up, what I like to refer to as a slingshot squeeze. So what happens is when squeeze starts setting up with negative momentum and the negative momentum starts dissipating and going back to zero, and then you start getting positive momentum over zero, watch for that squeeze to fire. If we get positive momentum, what I'd be looking for on Tesla is a break over 730. If we can get a break over 730, then Tesla can really start to run. And possibly we can get either this week or next week, get this squeeze to fire. So that's what I'd be looking for on Tesla. Goldman Sachs, still stuck in a bit of a range. It looks close, but you know, we're stuck between 348 and 392. So this could just be a chop range. You can take quicker trades on it, but I'm not seeing a bigger breakout until we get over 393. And at that point we can target 400. So seeing a lot of upper wicks here. So if I were to look at this more objectively, I would say if we get a weekly close over 377, could get a potential early entry and target that 393 region. All right, HD, home builders looking pretty good. We had a nice test of this 21 EMA here on the weekly chart, holding the 8 EMA now. RSI looking pretty good. But you can see the squeeze has been dissipating, as we can see in the falling price here. And what I'd be looking for now, you can see we are setting up with another squeeze here. So last time we squeezed, right, we got that nice pop up, but this squeeze was negative momentum. And this is a perfect example of the slingshot, right? Negative momentum coming up to the zero line. We get a positive momentum and then we get the squeeze firing. And as we hit that positive momentum, you're starting to already break out. And, you know, HD had this really nice move right over this breakout level here. So setting up again, what I would wait for is, you know, we might need a couple of weeks, but just keep an eye on 340. Over 340, I think this really can start to run. Next up, Johnson & Johnson. Picked up a cup and handle setup here. Let's see. Did break out this week, and we're holding the breakout. So what I would just watch for is a weekly close. You can see we did have a squeeze setting up a few months ago. And it looks like it tried to fire about 5 weeks ago, and it went right back into a squeeze. So it just wasn't ready to fire off at that time. So I'd be watching for a weekly squeeze firing on Johnson & Johnson. Next up is Square. Love how these patterns play out, right? You have a falling RSI. You get a break of 50 right on the trend line on RSI. You get a move off the bottom of the wedge to the top of the wedge. And now off this weekly candle, no surprises here. We had a fake breakout, fake out, right? Where are we right now? We're right underneath that wedge. So unless we get a close on the weekly over a about 267, then it's likely and possible that Square can come back down and retest the bottom of this wedge. The one thing to note, we do have a squeeze setting up. It is a slingshot squeeze, as I like to say. So if we get that squeeze, if we get that price breakout and close over 670, let's just call it 268, then it's very possible we get a continuation next week on Square. Next up is Net. Had a nice wedge breakout right to the top of our broadening formation. No surprises here. We're coming into resistance. RSI broke out. Now RSI on the weekly coming into overbought conditions. TTM squeeze, slingshot setup. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and we have 9 weeks of positive movement. This is a perfect example of a slingshot squeeze with all of the right metrics, how it breaks out, how after it fires, and look what it does. Is it always going to happen? No, it's not always going to happen like that. But here's another really, I just saw this, don't know why I missed this, but talking about the inside-outside reversal or inside-outside key breakout, right? You have your initial candle, you have an inside week, and then you have an outside week that closed over the high of the inside week. Then you had another outside week outside of this outside week, and then you had another outside week off of this outside week. So this is actually another broadening formation right here. If we went down to a lower time frame, you would see it. But this is a bullish setup. And look at what happened after you got that bullish setup. You could have just taken the break from here over 112 and caught, you know, almost 10 points up to 122 and could have seen this top broadening formation and sold into the test of that top broadening formation. So that's what I would call like a high probability trade. And you even have on this week, last week, the retest of the breakout level and then a bounce back up. So, you know, these are the things that we need to be looking for as traders for high confidence trades. Nothing really to see here on Lucid. Snow, you know, Snow's been okay. It just hasn't gotten that continuation over, 272. Where it looks like we're closing over it for now. And we do have a squeeze setting up on the weekly for a bit. It is a slingshot squeeze, but positive momentum is already pretty high without a squeeze firing. If the squeeze fires, I mean, RSI is in a really good range here. It looks like a little bit of a inverse head and shoulders as well. I definitely would say if we can get that break and close on the weekly over 275, then I think 300 are in the cards and then possibly up to 318 to 319 level. So those are the really, that's what's on my watch list this week. There have been day trades, obviously, that I've been taking and that I've been offering up for you guys. But from a weekly perspective, from a swing trading perspective, still not seeing a lot of continuation and momentum for swing trades. It's been really hard holding trades overnight, especially with options. With shares, I find it's a little easier because you're not getting crushed on premiums. But, you know, until the market really starts to break out, you know, we have the queues continually testing this 368 level. We tested it three times today. So far, it's holding. We have SPX holding over 4,400, but failing under 4,410. So, you know, the market is still stuck in a bit of a range. And what that means is that most of our stocks that we're going to be watching are going to be stuck in a range. So, yeah, we could take the breakouts of Zoom over 400 or the breakouts of, you know, for NVIDIA over 200. But, you know, we really have to take quicker profit and wait and sit on our hands until we get the market, you know, the overall market, whether it's SPX or QQQ or IWM, you know, cooperating. So those are really the charts that I wanted to go over as far as a review. Does anybody have any questions, any chart requests, anything you want me to go over strategy-wise, scanning? You know, while I'm waiting, I'll just run some scans to see, you know, what's showing up today. One scan I like to watch is my TTM squeeze fire. So let me go back down to a daily chart. Let's see. So PD's got a, that's page duty. It's got a daily squeeze firing here. So when I see a squeeze firing, I just want to go down my checklist, right? What's RSI doing? RSI is breaking out, all right? What's price doing? Price is breaking out. So you know what? Let's throw page duty on the weekly watch list. I wanna take a look at this more in depth, maybe later or tomorrow morning, and see if this might be, you know, a good setup that we can take this week into next, yeah, right? So you got your daily squeeze fired right there. What's a slingshot squeeze? All right, so what was that example? Let's go back to the weekly. Okay, I'm gonna find one that fired, and then we'll go over some examples of slingshot squeezes that are setting up. So this is a slingshot squeeze, basically in a nutshell. Let me make this a little bigger. All right, so most of you guys are using the TTM squeeze on Thinkorswim. It's very much the same on TrendSpider. It's just going to look slightly different, but the process is the same. So when you have a squeeze setting up, right, you're going to have your red dots. That means your squeeze is setting up. And sometimes your squeeze setup can be when it's positive momentum, and sometimes it could be when there's negative momentum. So basically, think about this. This middle line is your zero line. Below the zero line, that's negative momentum. These are your orange bars on TrendSpider. And above the zero line is positive momentum. That's going to be your blue bars on TrendSpider. Okay, right? Red dot, squeeze is setting up. Green dot, squeeze is fired. Okay, so a slingshot squeeze basically is momentum that is starting to move up when you're in a squeeze, right? So now you have momentum here at negative 10. Now it's at negative 8. Now it's at negative 5. And then when the squeeze fires, it's at negative 1. So basically your momentum is shifting to the upside, right? So it's low, it's a little higher, a little higher, a little higher. By the time your squeeze fires, I actually really like how this set up, because it on the squeeze fire, you tested the downtrend line. On the second weekly squeeze fire, you broke out of this trend line and you got that continuation, right? So this is what the slingshot is. It's lower momentum shifting to higher momentum. And look at how it carried Netflare or Cloudflare ticker NET up into the top of its wedge. So I don't know if you joined late, but maybe go back to the beginning when I explained this, but this was a really high confidence trade setup. You had RSI breaking out over 50 and breaking its trend line. You had a TTM weekly squeeze firing, and you had a trend line break on price. So for me, it checks a lot of boxes. Of course, I would go down to a daily chart and possibly a 2 hour look at my wave chart, you know, see where we are in terms of Elliott wave. You know, I had net in a wave 4 ABC pullback here. This is potentially the end of wave 5. So how I would kind of count this, I would say, all right, you know, maybe this is a 1, 2, 3, 4, and wave 5 is probably going to end somewhere around 125. Doing it fast just so we can get through it. But that makes a lot of sense, right? 125, because that's going to be the top of our weekly wedge. So maybe we get the top on net this week. Maybe we get the top on net next week. I don't know, but it's very possible that we're starting to top out. You know, it looked like potentially this was the end of the trend right here with this spinning top weekly, but momentum this week so far is higher. RSI so far this week is higher. So there's still a little left in the gas tank for net. It's just not a trade that I would take here unless it were to a counter trend to the downside. All right, F. Lopez is asking, got a question about squeeze on weekly and how you get that to find setups for quicker trades, smaller time frame squeezes, how do they relate, how to go from bigger to smaller using the squeeze. So it's a really great question. I would never use the higher time squeezes to do my day trading. I would only be using squeezes on the 5, 15, and 30 minute for my day trades. Probably 30 minute, more 5 and 15 minute, maybe 30 minute, depends. The 30 minute squeeze, if I saw 30 and a, let's say a 2 hour or a 4 hour setting up, that may give me a little conviction to hold a little longer. But you know, when you go into a trade, you have to determine before you go in, is this going to be a day trade or is this going to be a swing trade? If it's going to be a day trade, you really shouldn't let it turn into a swing trade because that wasn't your plan from the get-go. I'm not saying that you can't do that, but you shouldn't do that because then your bias is all messed up, right? Because your plan was, I'm going to buy today and I'm going to sell at XYZ. And if you hold into tomorrow, you're going to have to reformulate your plan. And it's like kind of like moving, like it's like moving stop losses. You just don't do it. So when it comes to swing trades, what I would look for is for lower time frame higher. So if I see like, for instance, like Nvidia, that's got a squeeze on almost every single time frame setting up. If I start seeing the 5 minute fire and that triggers the 15 minute firing and that triggers the 60 minute firing, then I'm going to be looking at, okay, maybe this is going to be a good setup for a swing trade because then those smaller time frames may trigger the higher time frames. Doesn't always happen that way, but you're going to have to inspect each time frame, each important time frame that you look at to see, does it make sense? It's kind of like a cascading effect, like dominoes. All right, no problem, my space. Trade Seekers asking, having trouble with risk management on my trades. I'm mostly taking the weeklies. I'm having difficulty cutting losers or losses. Could also be because I might be entering the trades at a higher point as well. So oftentimes there's a pullback I enter, which causes the premiums to drop significantly, sometimes 50% or more. From that point, it just becomes a waiting game, hoping for it to recover. I would like to have a 1-2 risk reward, but not able to see it. Okay, a couple of things you could do, Trade Seeker. One thing you could do is cut your size down a little bit, which gives you a wider, possibly a wider stop. The other thing you can do is go out to another week, go out 2 weeks, instead of using the weeklies, because with the weeklies, you know, you're going to get premium burn, especially if you're not getting great entries. What I would do is if you miss a trade, I always like to say there's always another trade. You have to wait for the pullback. Case in point was Zoom. You got the breakout of 400 and then you got the pullback to the 8 EMA, which also was at 400. And then you got a second opportunity on that. Why I sold when I sold, because it double topped and it was coming back down. So no reason for me to stay in that trade, need to cut the trade at that point. So, you know, if you have to journal your trades, first off, you have to understand where the mistakes are before you can fix them. But just those two things might help: smaller position size, give you a wider stop, and going out another week on the trade. The other thing is make sure you're trading stocks that have tighter spreads, because if you're having those issues will be exacerbated if you're playing something like SHOP or CMG that have wider spreads. Let me know if that answers your question. And DM me if you have any more. I can definitely give you some more specifics if you can give me examples of a trade you took, where you took it, where you stopped out. The devil is in the details. And so I would really need to see a little bit more about what you're doing to kind of offer you a little more advice as to how to fix or attempt to fix what's going on. Okay, so let's run some scans, right? So we saw PD, PagerDuty looks pretty decent. Slingshot squeeze setting up, RSI hovering at 50. We've got an inside outside week, right? You got your first candle, you got your inside candle, and now you got your outside reversal candle right here. Oh, I'm sorry, it's not. Oh, well, it looked pretty good. actually this candle here, I always forget the name of it. So the one where it's this is like a dark cloud cover right here. If Pockets was here, he would tell me what this is, but it's the opposite of dark cloud cover. I think it's a piercing pattern. That's what it is. So you got a piercing pattern right here on Pager Duty. That usually signifies a reversal in trend, right? So we were coming down, we've got the piercing pattern, and now we're coming back up. So this is looking more interesting the more I look at it. So definitely, like I said, putting it on the watch list. That looks pretty ugly on take two. That is an outside bar to the downside. It's also breaking this recent low. So this actually looks pretty good to the downside. From an Elliott wave perspective, this looks like a wave five top right there. So what I would look for on this, this looks like an ABC, pretty textbook. And what I would do is measure out my Fib extension from the swing high to swing low, and that's my target right there to the downside, right at about 146, right at that 1272 extension. It can come down more. You can get an extended C, and this can come down to 128, but this would be the first area I would look for a potential bounce on an ABC move down. All right, so it says squeeze fire, but this hasn't fired. It may have fired at some point, but this doesn't look like a slingshot squeeze. You see how it starts to look like a slingshot squeeze, and now with this candle and momentum down, it's starting to push lower. Also note how it's getting rejected at 50 on the weekly here. So this is bearish in my eyes. So I would look for take two TTW0 to come to the downside. Twilio, all right, definitely no squeeze firing. My apologies. I'm on the weekly chart. Let me go back to the daily chart here. Yeah, this makes more sense now. So squeeze is setting up, momentum shifted to the downside already. Couldn't get back over the zero line. RSI got rejected at 50 on the daily, and we're getting a squeeze firing to the downside. So that looks pretty right. Okay, now Twilio. Okay, inside day printed today. We have a squeeze potentially firing to the downside, RSI losing 50, right? So this is already in a downtrend, okay? So we can draw our trend lines. We're in a down channel. So, you know, nothing, not saying I would take this to the downside. You probably need below about 361. Before you're really looking to take this to the downside. The other thing I would look at from an Elliott wave perspective, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? Let's count this out. You got a wave 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So if I'm counting this correctly, you're gonna get an ABC correction. So wave A can still come down. What I would say I would look for, so from wave 1 to wave 5, this would be my retracement zone. I would watch for a bounce anywhere around 340 to 360. And then what I would look for is a counter trend rally here with a wave B, and then maybe a wave C down to 328. So that's what I would be looking for on Twilio. And TWOU, 2U, looks very similar to what I just counted out with Twilio. So, all right, so wave 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and take my originating wave 1 to wave 5 top. So again, I would watch this for 39 to 41 level on TWOU. So we got 15 minutes left. I could run some more scans or answer more questions or look at specific charts. Let's look to see for RSI. Any RSI breakouts today? ATOM, Well, that's definitely an RSI breakout and a trend line breakout. CERS, let's see if that was earnings. Yep, that was an earnings gap up. So this could be a PEG play. So PEG is your power earnings gap up. All right, so let's draw a trend line. Came right to the trend line. No surprises here. So I would watch for a break over. Now, RSI is in overbought territory. We did have a one dot squeeze form, but generally don't like, I'd like more like 4 to 5 dot squeeze setups, at least on the daily. So this could be interesting to watch. CRM, RSI back over 50, but looks like it's in a bit of a range here. But CRM setting up in a symmetrical wedge. Right? So setting up, not quite there yet. Looks like Etsy got hammered for earnings. Let's turn on after hours. Yep, that's an outside day right there. Seeing some support, previous resistance here, right? Support generally becomes resistance. So you could see we're breaking down a little bit, but really got to wait to see how we open tomorrow. But this certainly doesn't look good. Haven't looked at the numbers yet of what's going on. Somebody was saying Fastly broke down. Let's take a quick look at Fastly. Poor Fastly. Can't catch a break. I did have this broadening formation here on Fastly. Let's see where we're at with that. So it's kind of how that's looking, right? Possible retest at the bottom of this formation again. It just looks really weak. You know, can't even get excited until we're over this trend line, possibly over 75. You know, also, this is where buy the dip really doesn't work, right? So let's say you were in before earnings, let's say over here at 100, you bought the breakout of 100 and you held in through earnings, or this is a pre-earnings dump. I don't remember. I think there was either a release or this was the TikTok news, I think. Actually, I think this was the TikTok news. And then just dumps right into earnings. You get the earnings bounce, right? You say, all right, I'm going to buy the dip, right? We're coming up to 100. Now you got rejected at 100. Said, all right, now maybe I'm going to buy the breakout of 100 again. I'll start adding to my position. Then you get whacked again from this trend line. Now you're down to 50, right? Let's buy the dip, right? It's cheap. We bought it at 100. Let's buy it at 50. Well, guess what? Now we're down to 36, right? So buy the dip just doesn't work. It's better to cut losses and move on and put your hard-earned money invested into something that's moving higher, that's got momentum. There definitely will be a day for Fastly, but it's obviously not today. Let's take a look at Roku. So here is a broadening formation setting up right here. Could we have guessed where the bottom on Roku was on this dump? Let's see. All right, so there's your top of your broadening formation. There's your bottom. So where could Roku go to? Well, I would be looking for a bounce somewhere around 360 to 362. Again, I'm not going to be looking to buy that. If it starts to bounce, maybe, but I would keep a pretty tight stop on that because we lost this recent low right here, right? If we did a retracement from the move, well, we're right at that 618, which corresponds with this low. That makes a lot of sense. So if we hold 389, 388 level, then we might be able to start bouncing here. But if not, then, you know, likely we're going to come down to 786 at 362. That's right at that, you know, these things, you know, I didn't do this. I didn't know this was going to happen, but these things tend to happen. Excuse me. And then, you know, I would be watching for under 327. Under 327, and I think we can certainly possibly come down to 300 and then 272 at this recent low. So That's how it's looking. But you know what? When you zoom out, generally speaking, you get you can have a handle pull back 50% from the cup. So we're right at about there right now, right at about a 50% pullback on the cup. So this thing can turn around and come right back up. So let's wait for the earnings call and then see how the market reacts in the morning. All right, let's take a look. NVAX had a really good day today. Still stuck in a bit of a range, right? Got a little bit range bound here, but I think over that, you know, it's looking pretty good. False breakouts here, true breakout here. I think over. Over 236, could possibly see 263. In between there, I would look at probably around right at 250. So over 236, I would look for NVAX to hit 250, and then over 250, 263. But we had an RSI breakout today. We can also run our trend line off that and see. It's right, you know, getting a little bit of a peekaboo, but it looks like NVAX reports tomorrow. So it is what it is, right? And NVAX probably moved today based on the mRNA news this morning. So let's see how it reacts for earnings. Okay, F. Lopez wants to look at Tesi. I did say today you could take a quick trade on Tesla. But until we get over 730, I really just don't think this moves. I think we're going to get a lot of these, you know, midday or early morning pops. And then, you know, where it goes from there is anybody's guess. But until we get over 730, this is not a trade that you can swing. You have to take quicker profits. I'm just throwing these to the lower time frame for now. So, okay, let's take a look at Tesi, right? So you had TTM squeeze setting up back here. This is, again, a slingshot squeeze. Okay, we had a beautiful symmetrical wedge set up. Came right into the symmetrical wedge, got rejected. On the squeeze setup, the squeeze was setting up. Momentum was shifting to the downside. Price was shifting to the downside. Price started to shift to the upside. Momentum starts to shift to the upside. Now we've got our first candle on positive momentum. That was already your breakout candle. Now your second and your third candles, which have now your first two candles that have fired inside day, and so far an inverted hammer. But what I would note are these three wicks. That is selling pressure. That are sellers whacking buyers. They don't want that price higher. And the level is 715. What did I keep on talking about today? 715, 715, 715. If we can break over 17 and close over 715, that's great. But if we break 715 and you're taking a trade, you have to take quicker profits because, you know, breakout, rejected, breakout, rejected, breakout, rejected. And what I could do is let's go to the lower time frames, right? Let me just make sure this is on below. Let's go to a 65-minute chart. Now we get a little better idea of what's happening, right? So you've got that initial breakout here. Retest, failed, breakout, failed, came back up, retest, broke out, continued, failed, falling back, right? So this is what's happening. You know, you can't fight the tape. You have to be able to recognize what the trade is doing so you can adjust how you're going to trade it, if you're going to trade it at all, right? So if we have our wedge drawn out here on the 65-minute chart, let me just do this perfectly so we know this is right. I hate when it snaps. Okay. So to me, this looks like it's starting to break down. Let's zoom in a little closer. So on that last 65-minute candle, to me, that's a bit bearish. And look at what happened with on the 65-minute squeeze. You had a slingshot squeeze, momentum moved to the upside, but it never fired. And now it's swinging back down to the zero line. RSI is coming down, right? You can't go by one time frame when you're making a decision, whether that's day trading or swing trading. You have to do multi-time frame analysis. It's the only way. It's like trying to diagnose an issue with a car without looking under the hood. You got to get under the hood into these charts. You got to look at the candles and see what they're doing. All right. Got 5 minutes left. Any final questions, comments, complaints? All right. I guess everybody else is good. So, awesome. So I don't know, Mr. Bass, if this is your first, go through with the trade talks, but this is, yeah, this is kind of along the lines of what I like to do, for a midweek review. We'll look at charts, we'll go through some ideas, and you guys can get a better sense of how I trade and how I look at charts and what I'm looking for, how I see it. Yeah, good to be back, Raina. I'm glad to be back. It's nice to be back in my setup. Hate to tell you, but I'm going to be going back down to Florida in 3 weeks. We're trying to make some moves here. So in any event, definitely good to be back. Glad to have you, Mr. Bass or Mr. Bass. But that is my story, and I'm sticking to it. So have a great evening, Mike. Nice to meet you. Thank you for being with us. Glad to have you here. And thank you for everybody else for being here as well. And I will catch you guys in the markets tomorrow. Take care.